All right, so this is the Marine Ecology and Conservation field course that Matthias Loy and I run to the University of Washington's Friday Harbor Labs, which is on an island in the San Juan Island archipelago, and they are exposed to a bunch of different habitats, so big mudflats, rocky shores, cobble beaches, this crazy lagoon and intertidal creek that's really like a shallow subtidal habitat.
So the class is basically broadly covering how terrestrial ecosystems interface with marine ecosystems. So I'm teaching actually about old growth forests that occur in the Pacific Northwest. We know from the salmon runs that go up into the streams, into the forest, they bring nutrients from the ocean. There are birds that breed in those forests, but they actually fly up to 70 miles to get food in the ocean.
My group of three did a project on the blue mussel, which is actually the type of mussel you eat, like steamers, and their fear response to their predator, which is a little snail called a nucella.
They would use their foot to move, but then reach out with their bristle threads to attach themselves to each other or to whatever else is in the tank or near them.
We had four different species of sea urchins and also different sizes of sea urchins, and we wanted to see if there was different responses in fear. So if they moved more quickly, if they had different reactions to the different species or the different sizes.
We were also looking at fear response because that's kind of the theme we all took. But my group was looking at scallops and their swimming behaviors when they were exposed to Pycnopodia, which is a sea star.
I was in the group that worked on those anemones over there that we had shipped back to us. They're a kind of anemone that swims. In response to being touched by a certain kind of starfish, so a leather star.
We would put a leather star either next to, touching, or on top of a swimming anemone, and we would see how fast it took the anemone to react.
So this is a leather star, Dermisterius imbricata. One of the things that the students were doing is putting them near the anemones and on the anemones. And when you touch them to the anemone, at first it does sort of typical anemone behavior, which is sort of contract and try to hide. Then it swells up, inflates with water, and starts to twist.
How do animals perceive the environment? What's the perception of where the predators are? Where are the safe areas where an organism can sort of rest and forage, and where are the areas that they need to be more cognizant about the predators? And then ultimately, how do humans actually change that?
I think what they take away from that at the end is this idea of connectivity between habitats, between shore and land, between humans and animals, between wildlife and humans, between developed areas and protected areas. And I think what they see is that while you hear about, you know, these big global issues, climate change, ocean acidification, whatever, things that might feel out of your control, a lot of the interactions, a lot of the management decisions that get made are really hyper-local, right? Like this beach, this creek, this trail through the woods.